to start our class as usual, okay, as normal, we're going to start with the case study for the previous week's topic, which is on case study 4 on is it better to give than to receive, okay? So this is the case study. So you log into your VLE virtual learning environment and look up for case study 4. Okay, we're going to discuss right now. I give you some time to locate the case study. Okay, everyone dah dapat the case study?
Yes, sir.
Right. Oh, cool. Okay, now, this case study for what is this all about? What is this case study is all about?
Gift-giving.
Jump to Amelia Sofia. Hey, you guys. Guys, you guys need to switch. I need to see you guys. Right. Okay. It's about giving. Can you elaborate on that, Amelia Sofia? And you said something about giving just now. Or would you care to elaborate? Amelia Sofia. Amelia Sofia, you said something just now.
Sorry. The article stopped giving gift on holidays and whether it is something voluntary or something that is forced onto, and then there's also giving a gift as a social cause, and holidays. Is it about money making machine? Is it a money making machine? Sorry.
Okay, so meaning to say, when we give something, is it because we wanted to give, okay? Is it because of culture? Is it because of festival? Okay, festive like Christmas ke, Hari Raya ke, you know that. Culture, for example, culture like even in Malay culture, okay? I know this article is more about Americans and European, Western culture. But for Malay culture, in fact, when we go to someone's house, for example, there's a culture of bawa buah tangan, okay, buah tangan. A culture which I think most of us forgotten about that culture. You know? When we go to someone's house, for any occasion, then we bawa buah tangan. But the word buah tangan, right? But we never. I think that culture has been eroded. Okay, we have when we go to someone's house like berlenggang tangan, something like that. Am I correct? Berlenggang tangan. I don't know. Is it correct? Berlenggang tangan, right? So, or is it because of Amelia Sofia just said just now about many money making machines? All this been created, okay, for example, like Valentine has been commercialized. Okay, have been commercialized means marketers try to create an occasion for people to spend. Okay, people to spend money on gift, money making occasions, meaning you can give whatever you want to give, but marketers try to portray that you need to spend. Okay, you need to spend a lot during these occasions. Okay, so now that is the summary of the case study. So let's look at the question. Okay, look at what would be the key factors in choosing to buy a present? Nur Athira, what do you think the key factors in choosing a present?
The key factors. First, maybe I need to consider if the person likes or interest in the present that I give. Is it true?
Yeah. It's correct. You're correct. Well, we predict. Okay. There are some studies conducted on this matter. It says that when we buy presents, we try to predict what the receiver wants based on our assumptions. Does it correct or does it accurate or sometimes not? How about price? How about price?
Price, I need to. My budget lah, macam kalau mahal sangat, I pun tak mampu. How I nak beli mahal-mahal?
Yang macam kalau barang-barang kat Shopee tu kan, kita tengok price dia betul tak?
Betul.
Alright. Okay. Nur Ainul Hayat.
Hello.
Hi. No, I know how. Gambar, video.
Oh, no, I know how. Jap.
Okay, no, I know how. Is price determine whether will price will determine the sender or the receiver will value more about your present, meaning the more expensive the price, the more value put by the receiver of the price or the present.
It depends on the receiver because value is something.
What do you think? When you buy a present, do you look at the price?
Not really.
Because
value is subjective.
Say you want to impress someone.
Uh-huh.
Wanted to impress someone, right? Let's say you wanted to buy an engagement ring for your future wife. Okay? Is price is a concern for you to impress your future wife in buying a ring?
I mean, if my future wife is materialistic, then sure. It really depends on the person.
Okay, now I ask from opposite sex. Nurul Najihah.
Say.
Let's say someone give you a wedding ring. Then you know that the wedding ring costs him a bomb. Let's say a big fat diamond ring. Okay, will you be impressed by the fact that he bought you the diamond ring, or will you impressed with the price of that diamond ring?
With the design of diamond ring, I will impress with the design, not the price.
What about the act of giving you the diamond ring? What about the act of giving you the diamond ring? Meaning, someone actually giving you the diamond ring, is that impress you?
Yes, it's impress. Because the diamond ring is macam kalau diamond ring ni memang betul-betul mahal lah macam tu. Dalam kepala otak saya akan harga tu akan betul-betul mahal lah macam tu.
Alright, so why I ask you this question? Why I ask someone from male gender, and then I ask someone from female gender, because there is research showing that when guys when they buy a present, okay, guys usually look at the price, okay, because guys will say that the more expensive is the present, the more value people will put on that present. But for woman gender, a price is not something which is their value. They look at different factors. Okay, I'm not sure whether how accurate is this research. There may be some outliers. Okay, outliers mean there must be there may be some exception. Okay, in every research, there always be outliers. Okay, they always be some exception. Semua orang kata A, then tiba seorang kata B. That outliers. B tu outliers, right? So something which is out of the norms. Okay, norms. We're going to talk about norms later in our lecture when we talk about culture. Alright. So now, Nur Ashraf. Question number two, Nur Ashraf.
Yes, sir.
Question number two. Why do retailers offer such a vast array of gifts? Why do you think?
I think it's because it is an attraction for the consumers to purchase their brands, because as a gift, it symbolizes something to the receiver, and also to the receiver and to the givers. And also from there, the retailers can gain the advantages in terms of the profit and selling, in profits and sales, when they're promoting their products in a term where the product can be a gift to someone.
That is all right. Meaning, it's all about choice, right? It's all about choice.
Yeah.
Right. Because again, there are research showing say that you need to give a choice to your customer, or else the customer may go to different stores. For example, let's say you wanted to buy a television. Okay, you wanted to buy a television, then you go to this shop. Let's say you go to this electrical shop, then you only see one type of television. No choice, only one. Although that television may satisfy or may fulfill all your requirement, okay, in terms of budget, in terms of technology and all that, but you still think that, oh look, there's only one choice. You subconsciously you say that I need more choice. You go to different stores, and let's say you go to different store, then you have like five choices, for example, to choose from. Then you may somehow you feel that it's justified when you pick one type of television. You feel justified that you buy that option, okay? Rather than you go to, although when you choose that particular television in the second store, it fits all the requirement, is all the requirements, the price and everything is the same as the first store. Okay, the first store when you look at that one television, it fits all the bills, it fit all the your requirement, it fits all your what you're looking for in a television. But because the first store doesn't give you the option, right? So you go to the next store, which give you the options. So why, although when you go to the next store, when you buy that television, you're buying actually the same television as the first store, which only give you one option. This is very psychological. Why? Because when you wanted to make a purchase, you need to feel justified in your purchase. You need to how to justify your purchase is by to have many options. Okay, to have many options before you can make a purchase, especially if the purchase requires a lot of investment, meaning the price is quite expensive. All right. So okay, now Muhammad, no. Let's ask Muhammad Johan Alif. Johan Alif. Question number three. Where are you, Muhammad Johan Alif? Let me see you. Where are you? Hi, Johan Alif. So question number three, Muhammad Johan Alif.
Yes, sir.
What are your most popular reason for buying? What when you buy a gift, what's the reason?
Holiday and gift giving, birthday gifts.
No, yourself. This one, this question is about you. When you buy a gift, okay? Personally, why do you buy a gift to someone?
I will buy a gift to impress other persons. My friends.
Okay, all right. Is there any occasions, specific occasions that you buy gift?
Birthday.
Holiday.
Yeah, birthday.
Oh, birthday. All right, birthday. All right, cool. Yeah, that's that. That's one of the reasons, most popular reasons. All right. Hey, why I look at here, because my screen is there. Okay, the camera is here, my screen is there. Okay. So jangan macam dia ni kenapa tak memberikan tumpuan. No, the camera is here. Alright. My screen dekat apa tu semua kat sini. Okay, it's easier. Alright, number four. Let's see. Putri Nurjana. Question number four.
Yes, sir.
Where are you, Putri Nurjana? Okay, Putri Nurjana. Question number four.
Okay.
In what situation is there more satisfaction in giving rather than receiving? Meaning it gives you more joy in giving rather than receiving.
Benda yang dapat memberi kepuasan apabila memberi. Sebagai contoh, join aktiviti charity work dengan memberi makanan kepada orang kelandangan.
Why? Okay, that's a good example. Why when you give that kind of, like you doing a charity, right? You give food, okay? You provide food to the homeless, to the needy. It gives you the satisfaction. Why? You didn't receive anything. That homeless people cannot reward you in any way. Dia tak ada kerja. So macam mana dia nak bagi awak macam, and then dia pun tak ada Instagram. So dia tak boleh nak follow awak. But then by giving food to these needy people, to these homeless, it gives you satisfaction. Kenapa? It's very, very exciting or very interesting topic. Kenapa?
Sebab kita tahu dia tak mampu untuk membeli makanan ke apa, apabila kita memberi keperluan kepada yang memerlukan, ia memberi satu kepuasan untuk kita.
Yeah,
maksudnya kita dapat membantu dia dari segi apa yang dia perlu.
Alright. Okay. Kenapa? Okay. I know memberikan kepuasan, tapi soalan dia kenapa beri kepuasan pada awak?
Macam mana? Kenapa kita rasa puas memberi makanan kepada?
Because they appreciate it above all, above everything else.
What's that?
Satisfaction, seeing the expression on the face of someone that we give the gift.
Okay, you look at the expression, the facial expression of those homeless people when they receive the food. It gives you the satisfaction. Okay, now I wanted to dive deeper. Okay, on your emotional level. Awak nampak orang tu gembira bila dapat makanan. Dan ia memberikan kepuasan kepada awak. Kenapa? Kenapa benda ni memberikan kepuasan? It doesn't, okay, because when we talk about kepuasan, for example, when you eat, okay, when you eat something, you eat an ice cream, you rasa puas, right? It's still, you gain something. Okay, because you are eating the ice cream, dan awak rasa puas, awak rasa nikmat gila dapat makan ice cream, for example. Tapi beri orang lain makan, awak rasa gembira. You don't receive anything, but you receive, you feel the happiness. You do not gain anything for yourself, but you receive or you feel happy. Okay, this is something yang saya nak tahu kenapa. Can you explain why?
Okay, kalau compare bagi hadiah dekat orang yang dah ada duit, diorang tak perlukan hadiah tu, tapi we just give it. And if we bagi makanan dekat orang yang memerlukan, dia perlukan makanan tu untuk living their life. So bila kita fulfill their needs, it's actually like something meaningful lah untuk, sebenarnya something yang fulfilling untuk hati.
So it doesn't fulfill your ego, it doesn't fulfill your material objective of the world, but it fits your what? It fits your emotions, it fits your what? Your inner feelings.
Yeah, kind of like that.
It gives you something like you achieve something, you done something, you have you able to change the world, for example, like that. Is it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
All right. Do you remember when we talk about Maslow theory of needs? Remember, right? The pyramid, whereby we need to satisfy our basic needs or our survival requirement. Then we need to secure we need to secure our survival. Then we need to feed our egos. As we go top of the pyramid, we need to feed our egos. Then we need to feed our curiosity. And then on top of the pyramid is what? Self-actualization, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so this is basically self-actualization. Means when you give someone, for example, you give food to the needy, you give food to the homeless, you do not gain anything, okay? Gaining something is somewhere at the bottom of that pyramid of theory of needs, whereby you need to feed your egos, okay? You need to secure your basic survival. That is something for you. But when you do something for someone else, okay, you do something for someone else, so this is self-actualization, means you do something which doesn't benefit you, but it benefits someone else. So it's a self-actualization. So when you buy a gift, any product which is suitable to be presented as a gift, okay, it can serve two purposes. Mean one, it to feed your ego. Okay, why? Because, for example, like you give someone, let's say you make a donation, for example, then you put up in the social media. It feeds your ego, right? Or you just give someone, okay, you donated something, and you just keep quiet. And just keep quiet. Why? Because it satisfy your inner feeling. Like you do not need other people to recognize what you have done. So it's more of self-actualization. Okay, so when we discuss about Maslow theory of needs. Okay, all these are interrelated. Okay, that's why when Putri Nurjana talks about give food to the needy, give food to the homeless. Okay, it's suddenly it strikes me that this is very interesting topic. Okay, Putri Nurjana is quite, you know, is quite genius. Okay, when he talks about this giving foods. Okay, because rather than confine herself to the topic in this article, then she went on giving food, okay, to the needy. It's nothing to do with any occasions, nothing to do with Valentine, nothing to do with birthdays, nothing to do with Hari Raya, nothing to do with Christmas. Okay, right, cool. Talking about self-actualization. Okay, how can gift-giving become less materialistic? Is that Daniel?
I think by giving some meaningful goods, for example, that can give someone an experience. For example, parents can give their sons a vacation instead of giving toys. So from vacation, they can bring many experience and enjoyment to their kids and family. Macam tu lah. That's materialistic.
Are you sure vacation is less materialistic?
I think so, sir.
I think 30 years ago, maybe. But now I'm not sure. Okay, now, last time, 30 years ago, okay, you look at the social fabric, okay, 30 years ago for normal M40 to B40 to M40 strata, social class. I'm going to talk about social class after this. Vacation is a luxury. Okay, paling kuat pun maybe once a month makan kat KFC or McDonald's. Okay, 30 to 40 years ago. Okay, but now makan at McDonald's or makan kat KFC is a norm. Okay, it's like macam setiap minggu makan dekat McDonald's or KFC. Or then vacation, for example. Okay, it is an exception rather than a norm. Sekarang dah jadi norms untuk parents are expected to bring their kids for vacations. And last time, I can still remember every time. Okay, I came from a B40 camp family. Every time we go for not so called vacations lah. I know it's just like. We went out, for example, to somewhere outside Kuala Lumpur, for example. Okay, my family is an urban poor. Okay, we live in Kuala Lumpur and we are urban poor, then B40. So every time we went out from Kuala Lumpur, it's like something which is a treat. Okay, but when I grew up, okay, I went for vacation or I went for vacation and all that. Not domestic vacation, no. Meaning you fly somewhere, you fly abroad for your vacation, and I see parents bringing their small children, not small, around like 10 to 15 years old, something like that, and I can see the children like muka macam sok, macam masam, you know. Their parents bringing them for vacation. No, I know where the destination, because the decision is same as mine. Okay, but I can see these children sulking. Okay, the parents are taking them for vacation and these children are sulking, macam muka tak puas hati. Right,
maybe they not arrived yet on the destination, so they won't see yet.
They won't see, you know, that. And I got my friends, for example, okay, she brought her kids to kucing Sarawak. Okay, kucing Sarawak. They need to fly, right? And then she told me this story. Okay, she told me this story. She said that when they arrived in Kuching, then her children saw her pay someone using Malaysian ringgit. And her children asked, "Mama, why do you use Malaysian ringgit?" And then my friend said, "Yes, because we're still in Malaysia." And the children giving her a hard time. Why? Because they say that we're supposed to vacation abroad, not in Malaysia. Okay, you see how different is the generation from 30 to 40 years ago and to this generation. Parents are expected to bring children, their children to vacations, and not only vacation, it must be abroad, not in Malaysia. So this is how
Langkawi.
Yalah, now Langkawi, you have no choice, right? You cannot go abroad, then you need to cuti-cuti Malaysia lah, what to do, right? Nurul Najah, you from Langkawi ke? Tiba-tiba you macam muka tak puas hati tu. I'm not saying Ashraf. Okay, I'm just explaining about the generation gap. Okay, the generation gap. All right. I'm sure you guys are very grateful children. Okay. You guys are not spoiled brats. But there are generations right now who are expecting their parents to not only take them for vacations, but the vacation must be abroad. And there are children who expect parents to buy them gift, expensive gift, and not just normal gift. So this is how I don't know how you guys going to bring up your own children. This is something upbringing, right? Why? Because 30 to 40 years ago, people are not do not have wealth. People do not have that disposable income, high disposable income. People are still living, just to survive 30 to 40 years ago. Okay, my family included. But then, because of the education, better education, then parents now are better educated. With better education, they have better jobs, better good disposable income, so they can give luxury to the children. So this is the expectation, okay, the expectation of the current generation towards their parents. Okay, I'm sure you guys are not, although you guys are within this generation, but I'm sure you guys are not the spoiled brats. You guys are very grateful children. Okay, I'm very sure of that. Right, any other question? Okay, any question? What about culture? Is there any what do you call this, any influence on gift based on culture? Before we go to the lecture today about culture, what do you think? Is culture plays a role in choosing a gift?
Yes.
Okay. Nur Ashraf. Kenapa? Nur Ashraf ke Nur Ainul Hayat yang cakap tu?
Ashraf sir.
Yeah. Okay, Ashraf. Why?
It's okay.
Tak apalah, siapa-siapalah.
Boleh.
Bukan jadi markah pun, alright? Why do you think culture have any influence in choosing a gift?
To me, the gift depends. The culture is because
for example,
dia macam ada sentimental value gift tu terhadap culture sebut macam contoh culture apa macam Christian boleh cakap culture je. You just cuti kan macam Christian.
Christian is a religion, but giving of gift. Okay, gift during Christmas is a culture.
Yeah, macam tu rasa.
Christmas is a Christmas is a celebration to celebrate the birthday of the of Jesus.
Jesus, yes.
All right. But giving a present during Christmas is a culture. Having a Christmas tree is a culture. All right. Why? Because Christmas tree and that pine tree, you don't see that pine tree in Israel. No, Jesus is from that area, right? Hebrew. You cannot find those Christmas tree in Israel at that point of time. So Christmas tree is all about culture. Okay, Santa Claus is about culture. Okay, it's nothing to do with the religion. Turkey is not a culture. No, every time, because my wife is a convert. She's a Catholic from Kuching. Ooh. So every time I went back for Christmas, okay, my friend will ask me, "So you eat turkey, you know?" I said, why should I eat turkey during Christmas? I said, every time Christmas, I see people eat turkey. And I said, no, during Christmas, I saw a lemang on the table. A lemang and ayam panso on the table. So I don't see any turkey. So just imagine I'm eating lemang during Christmas. Okay, some people eating lemang during Hari Raya, but I'm eating lemang during Christmas. So it's culture, right? It's culture. But then the main question, okay, the most important question is, as a marketer, how do you use this, okay, buying of present or gift to someone else to your advantage?
Creating advertisement that can catches the people's attention and people's emotion. You can play people's emotion, such as Petronas. We can see Petronas commercial advertisement. I know it's not a brand or something, but it's focusing on petroleum, but it also emphasize on social culture that focusing on the relationship during festive season, such as Hari Raya, Deepavali, and Chinese New Year. Yeah.
How about the product development? How about the packaging, for example?
The packaging, they modify into according to the seasonal seasons. For example, gaming company Nintendo wrapping up their gift in a ribbon during Christmas. They wrap the gift into a Christmas presents box, and sometimes even consumers didn't as a game product, because the product are sealed tightly without any clue about the presence or the product itself.
Yeah. All right. Now, okay. What I noticed that if you go abroad, when you buy something, okay, especially expensive product or especially goods, they always give you in a box. The product will be in the box, right? So when you put something in a box, it's easier for you to present that goods or present that product as a gift. For example, like you don't have to go abroad, right? Let's say you're here in Malaysia, for example. You go and buy, say, L'Occitane, or you buy La Mer product, for example. Okay, La Mer product. So they put it in the box. Okay, you compare that if you buy something from Sendayu Tinggi, something like that, I'm not sure all those brands, they just give you in what, let's say, I'm not sure how Sendayu Tinggi is presented, but if you go and buy Body Shop, L'Occitane, La Mer, you know that, they give you in a very nice box, correct? So it's easier for you to use that product as a gift. Why? Because if it is in a box, the box itself looks nice, then you can wrap it up, it will look nicer, it look more presentable. So it you can use that as a gift. Means you can buy that product and give it to someone. Okay, easy. Rather than you buy a product which do not have a good packaging, okay, doesn't look a presentable packaging. So nak bagi orang pun malu. Okay, nak bagi orang pun malu. So it's somehow as a marketer, how you can use this giving or you use this nature for human to give someone else a present, because by using all this your packaging, okay, then Ashraf just said just now about making advertisement, okay, advertisement to get people to give something to someone else. So again, have the intention to give is one thing, but when you look at the product itself, whether that product is suitable for a present. Okay, for example, let's take Valentine, for example. Okay, Valentine is very classic case whereby marketers able to commercialize Valentine to hike up sales on chocolate, on flowers, on perfumes. Then you ask me, Sharin, why Valentine's always associated with flowers, chocolate, and perfume? I do not know. Why chocolate? Why do you give chocolate? When you like someone, you give them chocolate. Flowers. Why? Why liking someone, you give chocolate or flowers? Why?
Chocolate tu manis, so buat dia happy.
Okay, why chocolate tu? Alright, why chocolate tu manis tapi buat orang happy? Kenapa? Kenapa? Kenapa chocolate tu manis buat orang happy? Well, let's unravel a mystery today. Let's say you, okay, katalah awak tak sambut Valentine. Okay, katalah you guys now, Valentine is haram. Okay, fine. Okay, when you like someone, okay, when you like someone, you give that someone chocolate or roses or flowers. So kalau bunga, kenapa? Bunga tu waktu makan rasa happy, manis. Nurul Najihah. So bunga tu orang makan tak makan? Orang bunga tak makan pun. Let us another girl. Okay. Siti Nur Syazwani.
Yes, sir.
Why when you like someone, you give them chocolate or flowers? Or you expected someone to give you flowers and chocolate? When someone give you chocolate and flowers, you feel happy. Why? Siti Nur Syazwani. Where are you, Siti Nur Syazwani? Switch on your camera.
Saya tanya kalau bunga dengan coklat.
Mana awak open, switch on your camera. Open camera pula, bukan English. Switch on your camera.
Sir?
Yeah, switch on your camera. Hmm.
Tak boleh.
Tak boleh. Mereka pasti answer. Okay, kalau tak boleh buka kamera. Why you know that someone likes you, then you expect that someone to give you chocolate and flowers? Siti Nasya Zwani? Siti Nasya Zwani, where are you?
Yes, sir. Boleh ulang tak tadi sekat-sekat?
Oh, sekat-sekat, okay. Why do you think that when someone likes you, you expect that someone give you flowers and chocolate, you feel happy? Why?
For me, flower, no, but chocolate. Maybe because I really like chocolate. So if someone give me, so I feel more happy.
Why chocolate? Okay, now I'm talking about products, right? Just now we're talking about giving.
Why chocolate? Present. Because I like it.
Okay. Now we shifted our discussion on the product because we are marketers. We wanted to know for kalau orang nak bagi hadiah, dia kena bagi barang, right? So ni nak bagi barang apa? So now discussion is about nak bagi barang apa. What kind of product that want to give? So we talking about chocolate. So why chocolate? Why you appreciate chocolate? Sebab awak suka coklat. Kenapa awak suka coklat?
Maybe more meaningful. Maksudnya banyak daripada coklat tu, banyak kebaikan yang kita dapat. Coklat kan sedap. Lepas tu kita
sedap.
Walaupun coklat ni biasanya memang as a simbol orang bagi hadiah sesuai sebab Saya tak tahu nak cakap macam mana, tapi sebab memang kebanyakan orang like coklat.
Okay. But kenapa, why do you think that people associated chocolate with gift? Kenapa tak bagi gula-gula ke? Bagi tepung susu? Bagi pizza ke?
So, ni kalau dari perspektif sains dia ada ayat tu tapi saya tak ingat. Tapi kalau fokus on consumer behavior, macam kita ni consumer, kita selalu ditayangkan dengan macam movie atau macam romantic drama semua kan. And also involves the commercial advertisement yang memaparkan memasarkan produk yang related to chocolates. And also the flowers. Tapi flowers tak adalah banyak sangat commercial advertisement. Selalunya dalam coklat lah kebanyakannya. And also from that, kadang-kadang advertisers ni dia akan promotekan produk tu dengan certain macam Valentine ni, dia akan relate. So macam bagi saya dari situ dia macam kita dah macam dah terbiasa dengan commercial break macam tu, iklan macam tu. Lepas tu sebab tu lah saya rasa dia macam dia dah terbiasa as a lovers kita have to appreciate each other by giving chocolates and flowers, a bouquet of flowers especially, and also perfume. Tu je lah kot.
Yeah, you are right. This is something when we think about, yeah. Apa dia Siti Nasya Zwani? Awak nak cakap something tadi? Siti Nasya Zwani, awak nak cakap something tadi?
Ya, kalau daripada explanation tadi, pengaruh lah. Maksudnya orang lebih terpengaruh dengan tengok iklan-iklan macam tu.
conditioning. Okay, we learn about conditioning just now, right? We talk about conditioning a few weeks ago about we've been when our behavior been conditioned with something. So now we are talking about advertisement which has conditioned our behavior, whereby if someone give you chocolate, then he likes you. For example, like if someone give you pizza, for example, like jom makan pizza, like okay, jom makan pizza, right? But then when someone give you chocolate, then you started thinking, something wrong. Is this guy like me or not? Why? Because tapi guy A give you pizza, guy B give you chocolate, but pizza and chocolate give you two different set of meanings, right? Then you say we're talking about just now about advertisement which condition our perception about the certain product. Is condition our perception about the product means if you buy pizza, it's just a matter of for you to because you're hungry. Okay, because you're hungry, you eat pizza. So if someone give you pizza, then you say, okay, good, cool, all right. You don't think twice after Bismillah, you terus makan that pizza. But then when someone, a guy give you chocolate, okay, bukan candos, bukan chocolate candos, dia bagi paci chocolate, for example, nicely wrapped. Then you will start to think the meaning behind the chocolate. Okay, so those are again, okay, this is again about consumer behavior. Okay, because when we talk about consumer behavior, we learn about the behavior of the consumer, the psychology behind our action. So these products, okay, there are certain products which are related to certain occasions. Okay, macam cerita saya tadi, Christmas and Turkey. Why? Because in a lot of Western movies, whenever they have Christmas, they eat turkey. So we are being so conditioned. Okay, our mind is so conditioned that if Christmas, we must eat turkey. In Christmas, there must be exchange of gift. During Christmas, it must be Christmas tree, for example. Okay, Christmas tree. So it's all about conditioning. Okay, it's all about conditioning which condition our behavior. So we have learned about conditioning 3 weeks ago. All right, any other question about this article before we move on to our lecture today? We talk about culture. Our topic ataupun our article just now, our case study, although talking about gift, but it has something to do with culture as well, which related to our lecture today. Alright? Ada soalan? For this article. Alright, kalau tak ada soalan, then we move on to our lecture today. So, you have culture, subculture and social mobility. Okay, kat bawah tu dia ada dua. Culture, subculture and social mobility, which is the PDF of the presentation. Bawah tu is the case study. Okay, we're going to discuss next week. So you switch on or you open, you click on the culture, subculture and social mobility. Okay, I have not finished marking your individual assignment, okay? But by 15th of November, you're supposed to receive or you're supposed to be able to look or to able to check on your marks for your individual assignment and whatever you have sent. Okay, whatever you have sent for marking, right, should be available on the 15th. Okay, we are still waiting for me to downloading this. So this lecture is quite interesting. Okay, while downloading this, okay, take some time. To this lecture is very interesting when we talk about culture. Okay, very interesting topic. Why? Because culture is something that we can see. Okay, we can see the culture. We experience that culture ourselves. So it's very interesting. Okay, I quite like this topic, culture. We can talk about culture until they finish counting the U.S. presidential votes. Still downloading. Did you guys watch or keep up to date on the U.S. election results?
Yes, sorry, sir. Wak Teram dengan Abang Bidin, sir.
Abang Joe Bidin.
I'm not talking about... I'm quite interested. When I look into the elections, I'm not interested on who's winning, but I'm looking at the... Okay, from the election itself, you can look at the culture. Okay, you can look at the behavior. Okay, the behavior of the voters. Okay, how do you manipulate the behavior of the voters? That is what I quite interested when I look into the whatever elections. Either it's Malaysian elections, it can be the U.S. elections. You can see as a marketer. Okay, as a marketer, I'm quite interested to see how. Especially on the behavior of the voters, okay, the behavior of the voters, how people vote, what influence people to vote, okay, or influence the voting pattern, and those are the things which I looking for. All right, I'm looking at the social media of those of the campaigns and all that. So those what interest me. All right. So what's your observation about U.S. election just now? Just now, Ashraf, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What was your observation on U.S. elections? What do you see? Your takeaway on the elections?
Especially on
the behavior of the voters.
I think so far behavior of the voters dia macam suram lah because of the during COVID-19 pandemic. Tapi macam orang kuat support macam Trump campaign and Joe Biden campaign ni, diorang memang mainkan peranan lah as a voters to promote the diorang punya minister punya campaign. Tapi dari segi macam pemimpin pula, Trump ni saya rasa dia macam go overboard sikit sampai even dia file a lawsuit against the court if I'm not mistaken, because he believe that the court have miscount the voting and therefore he orders the court to recount it back again the voting ballot. Yeah, dari situ pun dari situ pun pemimpin pun saya rasa nampak dia macam mainkan peranan dia lah as a untuk meyakinkan voters to vote for him to become the next president.
Right. This is if you look at the voting pattern, it's just like the buying pattern as well. Okay. Why? Because when you look at the pattern, people will vote basically along the party line. People will vote on, for example, the voters for example Democrats, for example, okay, will be in urban areas, And voters for Republican are more traditional. They are more at the rural areas. Okay, that's what, if you look at the map, okay, the blue state and red states, you can look at the locations, like location in New York, Washington, right? California are all blue, which is the Democrats. And the red states are all in the rural areas, okay? Then you may want to ask me, but Sharin, then how is that relevant to bias behavior, for example? Okay, bias behavior is, for example, let's say you wanted to sell something which is more controversial, more up to date. Okay, it is more on urban areas. Okay, so if you go for traditional, okay, traditional, for example, like traditional design and all that, so you go for rural areas. Okay, so why I look at the political scenario, it's not because I'm political, but you can see the similarity between how people vote and how people buy or how people choose to buy certain products. Okay, so it is the same. It kind of the same. Correct? There's the same thing when you vote for, let's say, previously, for example, like Academy Fantasia, for example, a few years back. Okay, you can look at the voting pattern. Okay, when you vote someone to become winner for Academy Fantasia, all right? I give you one example. Okay. Tapi Academy Fantasia ni zaman korang ke? Ke sebelum korang? Zaman korang juga.
Zaman okay. Kita orang.
Okay, let's take example Maui, for example.
Maui.
Why people vote for Maui, not Felix? Not Masha, for example. Why? Why do you think that people vote for Maui, not Felix, not Masha, not the other contestant yang aku terlupa nama dia? I just make some quick Google study just now before this class about Academy Fantasia. So, why do you think people in Malaysia vote for Maui? Is it because of the voice?
Religious and humble.
Okay, you say that Maui is humble. Okay. Humility. Do you trying to say that Masha ke the other contestant doesn't have that humility, doesn't have that humbleness, for example?
Because during that time, the landscape in the radio is like nasyid, lagu nasyid bagai. So they fit the what is famous at the moment.
Yeah. Yeah. In some sense you're right. Okay, because the character, okay, the character it suits the majority of the viewers. Okay, the majority of the viewers character suits the participant. Okay, because if you look at, for example, it's the same with American Idol. Okay, those who want American Idol, they fit the criteria. It fits, for example, those who sing country music, must be white. Okay, white must be. Okay, can we stop for a while for Azan? Alright, so the same thing with American Idol, same thing as Academy Fantasia, same thing now is Gegar Vaganza and all that. The main attraction why people vote for someone is not because of the, not more on the talent, not more on the performance, but more on the character. Okay, the same thing as elections, for example. You don't, when you vote someone, you don't, most of the time you don't vote for the performance. We look at the character. Okay, so the same thing as a product. Most of the time we don't look at the performance, we look at the character of the product. Okay, the character of how do you portray the product to the consumer. Okay, now then you may want to ask me, Sharin, what is this US presidential election, all this Academy Fantasia, American Idol, you know, that got to do with our lecture. Okay, now it has a lot to do with the culture. Okay, just now Ashraf said something about at that point of time, nasheed or something similar is the in thing at that point of time. Or I may rephrase that. I would like to say that the Islamization, okay, Islamisasi of the Malaysian or the Malay culture, in the Malay culture, all right, the incubation of Islam in the Malay culture, Islam been entrenched into the Malay culture. All right, so let's look at the culture. You look at the slide. Okay, the first slide is just some gambar. Then second slide is like the title, culture, subculture, and social mobility. So social mobility is the same as social class, right? Social class. But then when we look at this topic, okay, we are looking at this topic, not only we wanted to learn about culture. Okay, it's not only we want to talk about culture. We wanted to see how culture influence the way people buy the product. Because culture is actually a society's personality. You wanted to see the personality of the society, a specific society, you look at the culture. Then this culture will influence how people look at the product. How do you see a product depends on your culture. Okay, that's why it is so important that we learn about culture. Ini bukan lecture titas. Okay, ini bukan lecture hubungan etnik. Alright. Although titas and hubungan etnik talks about culture, but this lecture, when we learn about culture is consumer behavior, we wanted to see how culture influence people to see a product. For example, like a turkey, for example, ayam Belanda. Okay. As a Malay, when I look at a turkey, ayam Belanda, it's just a mere bird, mere ayam. All right, nothing much. But for, let's say, for Westerners, Christians, when you look at turkey, it reminds them of Christmas. It reminds them of Thanksgiving. So how people look at certain product, the perception of the product depends on the culture. Okay, so as a marketer, you need to be able to tell this, how certain people with different culture look at certain product. Okay, all right. Now, what is culture? Okay, culture is a set of shared belief, means a common belief. You and I believe in something the same, right? Shared belief. Okay, why I said you and I? Because I think most of us here are Malays, right? So basically, we have this shared belief on Malay culture. Okay, in general. Okay, in general, we have this what we call a Malay culture. Attitudes, okay? Attitudes, culture is a set of shared belief. Okay, one, shared belief. Second, attitudes. Attitudes and behavior associated with a large and distinct group of people. So, for example, like, you and I here, most of us are Malays. Okay, most of us are Malays. So we share the same set shared belief, the same attitudes, or the same behavior. I'm not saying that we are the same, but there are certain things on the surface. Okay, on the surface, certain things that we share the same thing. Like if you go to my house, you instantly take off your shoes. All right, so that is a shared belief. Okay, although you are not the same, your attitude and behavior may not be the same, 100% the same with me, but on the surface is all the same. If I go to your house, for example, I will take off my shoes. Right, so this is something what we call a shared belief. So you don't say that, okay, culture is something which is everyone is the same. No, this is something which is on the surface. Okay, so a Malay culture is something which on in general, all Malays will live with that shared belief. All Malay will have that general attitudes, and all Malays will have that general behavior. Okay, so as I said just now, everything, most of the time there will be outliers, but this is what I'm saying, that in general. Okay, in general. All right. All right. Any questions on this about culture, about the definition? This is just the definition of culture. Ada soalan tentang definisi culture ini? Any question? Tak ada. No, Farida. Farida Hanim. Farida Hanim.
Ada ni, sir. Ada.
Okay. Risau bila awak senyap.
Ada je. So tak tanya saya, sis, diam lah.
Oh, yes. Okay. Alright. Now.
Sir.
Yeah.
What is the difference between stereotype dengan culture?
Stereotyping is, okay, now. Okay. You may be referring to something like, if you see someone talking with loud voice, you associated someone with certain culture, right? If you see someone is pengotor, then you associated them with some culture, all right? So that is stereotyping. Culture is something, a shared belief by a group of people. Stereotyping is you making a generalization. Okay, it may be related, but stereotyping is, it has a negative connotation in it. Okay, because when we talk about culture, we talk about shared belief, attitude and behavior. So it just is, in terms of language, it's quite neutral. Okay, in terms of language, it's quite neutral, because you talk about Malay culture. Okay, so if you ask someone, why do you do this? Oh, according to the Malay culture, okay, it is a Malay culture for you to take off your shoes before you enter a house. So that sentence, when you say a culture, Malay culture, the connotation in terms of language is quite neutral. Okay, it's quite neutral. Rather than you say, when you say generalization, when you stereotype something, in terms of language, it has this negative connotation in that sentence. The word stereotype, it has, so this why you need to learn on how to communicate. For example, that's why some people ask me, why I cannot get credit transfer for business communication? Dah masa diploma dah ambil dah, kenapa masa ijazah kena ambil lagi? Well, okay, my answer will always be like, you need to learn how to communicate, all right? How to communicate effectively. you need to learn about language. Although the word culture and stereotyping, it may have the, it not the same, may have a similar, may have a similar. Okay, when I say similar means it's not 100% the same. It may be similar, but in terms of language, okay, in terms of language, the word culture is very neutral. You do not have any malice when you say that it is a culture. Okay, but when you say that you stereotyping someone, yes, some negative. The choice you have, it has a negative connotations. So that's why when you write something, for example, okay, when you write something, your choice of word, okay, your choice of word, me, okay, sometimes the word, okay, your intention may be different, but your choice of word gives some negative connotation to the receiver. Okay, right? So your question just now, what's the difference between culture and stereotyping? My answer is it is similar in certain sense, but on terms of language, culture is more positive, is more neutral. Stereotyping is, it has in terms of language, it has some negative connotation to it.
So
okay. Yes, Mia Faridanin.
Nak tanya.
Yeah.
Kan nanti yang ada next slide tu, kan culture dia ada macam pelbagai elemen kan, macam language lah, custom, belief tu semua kan. So kalau yes, yang macam kita kan Melayu kan, macam kita Melayu kan, macam pinjam culture daripada Cina bagi duit raya kan, pau. And dia tu kita dikategorikan dalam pinjaman culture jugalah kiranya kan. Tapi antara those element yang pinjaman culture kita daripada Cina bagi duit raya tu dalam kategori apa sebenarnya? Sebab saya tengok macam ada macam berdasarkan norms tu macam tak related je. Macam kita pinjam daripada Cina tu. So benda tu macam mana dia, antara elemen apa?
Is there such thing as pinjaman-pinjaman culture? I know that there is a discussion in Twitter about this. Okay, whereby pinjam-pinjam culture ni. Alright, when someone, let's say a Malay wearing a cheong sam, or a Chinese wearing a baju kurung. Well, my answer will be, okay, my answer will be, oh, what do you mean by culture? Okay, what do you mean by culture? Is there such thing as pinjaman culture? Is there any culture which is so pure that you do not pinjam from anyone?
No. Semua pinjam-pinjam.
Papua New Guinea. Okay. Why Papua New Guinea, you said that there's no pinjaman culture? Or I need to come up with this term, okay, pinjaman culture ni. As academician, we need to come up with the term. But as at now, let's all of us agree that we wanted to talk about pinjaman culture. Okay, culture pinjam-pinjaman from other culture. So is there such a thing? Okay, we look at the definition of culture here. Alright, culture is a set of shared belief, attitude and behavior associated with a large and distinct group of people. Is there anything to say that it must be pure?
No.
It must be original. Is there any such thing as original culture? You said just now about Papua New Guinea. Then why okay, based on your argument, why Papua New Guinea, Muhammad Amin, right?
Yes, sir.
Mama Amin, why do you think that Papua New Guinea have some pure culture?
Because their community was isolated, and then they was not colonized by any penjajah dulu. So I guess they live on their own, and then they find their own ways of doing stuff, and I guess that's their own pure culture, I guess.
Correct. You're right.
Ah, yeah. Tapi cuma dia case terpencil lah. Maksudnya, if we try to discuss these terms of copying culture and everything, I guess tak sepatutnya kita masukkan diorang. Sebab diorang tu memang special case, memang isolated.
Okay, talking about pinjaman culture, copy from other cultures. Right, culture is evolving. Even Malay culture, we evolve. You cannot find an original Malay culture. Right? In fact, a Malay today is different from Malay in the era of Melaka Sultanate. Zaman Kesultanan Melayu Melaka. Malay today and zaman Melayu Kesultanan Melayu Melaka dulu is different. Correct? Why? Because we evolve. Okay, now I give you one example. Like Malay weddings. Can you tell me what is the original Malay weddings culture? The original one. What is the original?
Merisik,
okay. Then?
Tunang. Dan nikah, tu je lah.
Alright, nikah. That nikah, why Malay bernikah? What? Is that bernikah tu, is it a culture or is it a religious influence? Boleh tak? Malay, awak kata pure Malay, right? Pure Malay. Boleh tak macam awak jumpa awak yang awak suka, kata okay sekarang kita bernikah. Sekarang kita adalah pasangan suami isteri. Can you say that? Why can you say that? Because you need to bernikah. So that pernikahan, akad, okay, akad. What is that? Is that a religion, religious thing?
Tuntutan agama,
right? So now that tuntutan agama, it become entrenched into the Malay culture. So now we are talking about copy culture. So what on earth is copy culture? Because culture is something which is evolving. Then I still talking about Malay weddings. Okay, and then you have what? Persandingan. Correct? In a normal Malay culture, Malay weddings, sometimes you see persandingan. So where is persandingan come from, originated from?
Orang India.
That's the thing. How does it entrench to Malay culture?
Mungkin sebab dia dah duduk kat negara kita, so kita pun ikutlah dia punya culture.
Assimilation. Just now, Muhammad Amin Rafiq talks about Papua New Guinea, right? They are isolated. Why? Because they do not have any contacts with other people from other culture. So the moment you have an interaction with people from different culture, then somehow you interact, or that interaction will attract some assimilation. You say, this culture have persandingan. Somehow it looks nice. Okay, it looks nice that if we import that culture to become our culture. Alright, that's persandingan. Then now we have what? Bridesmaids. Kan selalu kalau awak tengok Instagram your friend yang dah kahwin-kahwin tu, nanti ada bridesmaids. Yang pengantin tu baju lain, yang bridesmaid kawan-kawan dia tu pakai baju yang sama. Where does it come from?
English.
Is that a Malay culture?
No, sir.
But it become a Malay culture, right? It become part of culture. Setiap kali nak kahwin, kena ada bridesmaids.
So maksudnya kalau macam trend pun, anda kata macam trend dekat luar negara, kalau kita bawa tu pun boleh jadi macam kita punya culture jugalah kiranya, kan?
Okay, as I said, culture is something which is evolve. How does it evolve? It evolve because the interaction between two cultures or multiple cultures, right? Like Malaysia, for example, is like a melting pot of cultures. Okay, meaning you have Indian, you have Chinese, you have Kadazan, you have Dusun, you have Iban, you know that. So that become a melting pot of cultures. Then when we interact, then of course there will be some essence of the other culture then usurping into our culture. Correct. Then you asked something just now about copycat, okay, copy culture, for example. I heard some discussion or some polemic or debacle in Twitter about copy culture ni. So, which I cannot understand why, because when you interact with other culture, that definitely there will be some assimilation of cultures. Because culture doesn't mean that it must be original. For example, now, this T-shirt that I'm wearing is not a Malay culture, but somehow it become a norm. It's something which is acceptable for a Malay to wear a T-shirt. Correct? And then Malay names, for example. Malay names. Can you give me a pure Malay names? From this list, I can say there's nothing pure about your names. Nothing Malay pure here. I didn't see Bunga. I didn't see Kenanga. You know that here. I see Siti No Shakira, for example. Siti No Shakira.
Yes.
Your name, Siti No Shakira. Where does it come from, Siti No Shakira? Is it a Malay names? But it is an acceptable Malay names. But do you think that it has some Arabic influence there, Siti and No Shakira?
I don't know.
All right. Can you tell me pure Malay names?
Cempaka,
yes. And that's Kenanga, Kuntum, for example. Bulat.
Rogaya, sir. Rogaya.
Bulat. Okay, Rogaya maybe some form of Arabic. Okay, Arabic. Okay, now, you look at the names. Okay? You look at the names of Malays, for example. You can see that the different culture. Because maybe last time you have Bunga, Kuntum, Kenanga, you know that. Then after in 1970s, you have, as Noor Ashraf said something about, Islamic influence in Malay culture, the names is different. Okay, the name become different. Mulalah ada nama-nama yang little bit of Arabic. There's a bit Arabic. And then 1980s, there you see 70s to 80s, you see the word, for example, like girls, for Diana, for example, Farah, for example, or some English influence a little bit. Okay. Then now they come back to a little bit of Arabic as well, macam even you see at the spelling, for example, like Siti No Shakira. Okay, I think in 1980s or 1970s, if the word No Shakira, the spelling of Shakira is Syakirah, but now what year do you born, Siti No Shakira? 1980s, is it? 1990s, right? Almost to 2000. And the spelling is Nurshakirah. Why? Because it is spelled not Shakira, it's No Shakira. Alright? What influence is that?
Tajwid.
Islamic or Arabic. Okay, Arabic influence. Okay, Arabic influence. So that is culture. Okay, that is culture. All right. So I don't believe on copy culture, but the term is assimilation. Why? Because the moment you interact with the two or more culture, when they interact, there will be an interaction. There will be an assimilations, and people will copy, or people will take a culture or a foreign culture which they think good for them, and over the time, it become that culture for that particular group of people. For example, when I give you example like Malay wedding just now, okay, Malay wedding. Now it is a Malay culture for persandingan. So whenever you see a persandingan during a Malay wedding, you see that this is a Malay culture. But we cannot deny that persandingan is actually not a Malay culture. It's a culture which we pinjam from Hindu culture, Indian culture. So it's like then it become our culture. Okay, after 100 of years, then it become Malay cultures. Now bridesmaids, for example, now become I can see a lot of my students now when they married, they will be bridesmaids. So I think for 5 to 10 years after this, in future, it become a Malay culture as well to have a bridesmaids. Lepas tu sekarang ni dah ada pula apa, dah nak beranak tu, dah ada baby shower pula. Baby shower is not a Malay culture. But then it is from Western culture, but now slowly becoming people are practicing, or people are doing baby shower. I am not surprised for 15 to 20 years in the future, it become part of Malay culture. In Javanese, we have melenggang perut. Okay, that is subculture. Okay, subculture. Alright. Nur Farida Hanim, good question. Saya dah bermonolog for the next 5-10 minutes.
Tak apa, right. Saya tak apa.
But it's an interesting question. But because I say that culture is a very interesting topic. Okay, but whenever whatever discussion that we have on culture, you need to go back on the original question that I give you initially. That culture, why we learn culture? Because we wanted to see how people look at the how people look at the certain product. Because culture is a social reflection of a society, and how people look at certain product depends on the culture. Okay, so for example, just now when you have bridesmaids as part of Malay culture, now sekarang ni maksudnya wedding planner tu dah kena ada lah. Maksudnya it created a demand for wedding planner. It created a demand for wedding photographer. Okay, those are things that as a marketers you need to be aware of our different culture, meaning a shift in the Malay culture. For example, now you say that in the Malay culture, before you get before wedding, okay, you need a wedding planner. Wedding, you need bridesmaids. Wedding, for example, now you need pelamin, for example. Okay, last time for Malay culture, bertunang you don't need pelamin. Now masa bertunang pun dah ada pelamin. Alright, masa bertunang dan kahwin pun dah ada posters. So this create demands for products. Okay, as a marketer, you need to look at the shift in the culture, so you can predict what are the demands for products which come with shift in culture. Right, any other question?
No, any, sir.
No questions, right. Alright, okay, subculture. Okay, subculture is a set of belief and attitude which, while part of subculture, represent a distinct separate set. Meaning, for example, just now when I talk about Malay culture, Then Javanese culture, right? Melenggang perut. So, melenggang perut is a subculture. Okay, melenggang perut is a subculture from the general Malay culture. Alright. So, but why I say it's subculture? Because only part of factions in Malay community use that subculture, meaning a Javanese community using is practicing melenggang perut. What they call this different type of Malay, like Banjar, like Mandailing, like Riau, doesn't practice what they call this melenggang perut. Okay, only Javanese are using or practicing melenggang perut. So this is subculture. Then you have baby shower pula. Okay, melenggang perut doesn't sounds nice. Okay, doesn't sounds hip. Baby shower more trendy. So baby shower ni is a subculture because although there are certain set of Malays using or practicing baby shower, but other parts of Malay factions may not use this baby shower. Okay, so this is a subculture, alright? Meaning a culture within a big culture. Okay, the subset of the big culture. Right, now, next slide. Okay, next slide. Okay, culture can be influenced by macro and micro. Okay, that's why I said that there's no such thing as pinjam or copy culture. Why? Because a culture is something which is evolved. It evolved in certain times. Okay. And it is influenced by macro environmental factors, okay, and micro environmental factors. For example, like family and friends, for example, like social interactions. Okay, when you interact with your friends, okay, then maybe awak tak pernah ada baby shower, tapi your friend ada baby buat baby shower. Then your interaction with your friends yang buat baby shower tu, then you say that, oh, this is something a new culture. Okay, sebab kawan awak dah buat baby shower, nanti awak dah kahwin dan ada anak pun buat baby shower juga. So it become why awak buat that baby shower? Because your friend did it. How do you know that? Because your interactions. Okay. Right. Next. Okay. This is the slide yang Farida Hanim cakap tadi. Language, mores, custom, belief, myth, rituals, food, custom. Okay, now let's look at this one. Meaning to say, this culture was influenced by all these factors. Okay, all these factors will influence the culture. For example, like religion just now, pernikahan. Okay, pernikahan. For example, there is a culture in Iban. Okay, in an Iban culture. If you like someone, okay, if you look someone, if you can stay overnight with that someone for 2 or 3 nights, and then after 3 nights, if you still staying together, then you are considered to be married. Okay, that is culture. Okay, that's culture. But when religion comes in, then religion say that before you can be with someone as husband and wife, you need to have this religion process whereby for Islam you need to go for akad nikah. Alright, so that's why in Malay, okay, in Malay, that Malay wedding, there's a pernikahan. Okay, so pernikahan is a religion influence. Okay, pernikahan is a religion influence. Persandingan is something which is a custom. Okay, it's custom, it's a culture. Okay, let's look at this one by one. All right, religion. So what is religion? Religion is something which that for the burial of the dead. Meaning Religion means it tells you what to do and what not to do. In Islam, halal and haram. Okay, and this in Islam, for example, it teach you Islam as ad-din, Islam as the way of life. So it tells you on how to live your life from the day one you are born. Okay, you have been tahnik ke, and then cukur jambul. Cukur jambul. Cukur jambul is actually is a combination of is religion and adat, okay, and custom. Why? Because religion say that after 7 days, okay, 7 days after you are born, then you supposed to shave all the heads of the babies, and then you timbang the hair, and then you sedekahkan based compared to the goat. But now, and then you kikah, alright, akikah, do the akikah. But now you have majlis cukur jambul after 3 months, okay, 3 months down the road and buat cukur jambul, okay. Then last, this custom is dah cukur jambul, then put the hair in the kat dalam what do you call that, kelapa, for example. That is custom. Islam doesn't teach that. That so Islam teach you what, how do you live your life from the day you are, first day you are born, until your dead. Mean how do you bury your dead? Okay, then Islam teach you how to do that. And then language, okay, language. Now language is something. It is a form of communication. That something that that you can understood. Okay, how does language, okay, how does language influence your culture? For example, like if you don't understand English language, then how can you understand the English culture, for example? Sebabkan awak tengok cerita Western about when they get married, there's a bridesmaid, you understand what they're talking about, then that's how you embedded that into your wedding. Meaning when the moment you want to go for wedding, then you need to have a bridesmaid. How do you learn all this? Through language. Okay. Norms. Okay, norms. Norm is something which is passed down, or behavior passed down from your father to you, and to your son, and then your son to their son, and all that. So it's a norms. Okay, what is the difference between culture and norms? In Malay, what we call kebiasaan. Okay, culture is budaya. Norms ialah kebiasaan. Okay, so norm is something which is you always do that. Okay, it's not it's some sort like culture, but it is not shared by in general. It just you or certain people we do that. Okay, people will do that. For example, in Twitter, for example, I think last month, okay, sometime in the middle of last month, somebody talking about when he went to his uncle's house. Okay, it is a norm for women to, when they eat, okay, lunch, dinner, whatnot, it is a norm for the woman to just watch the man to eat first. Then if the man need anything, then the woman will tambah the nasi and all that. Then after the man have eaten, then only woman will eat. Okay, and he said that this is a Malay culture. Okay, and then I can see from the barrage of comments, he said that, hey, look, no, it's not a Malay culture. I'm also a Malay. I doesn't practice that. All right. The woman and the man eat together. Okay. But according to this Twitter, according to this guy, it is a norm. It is a culture. He assumed that it is a Malay culture. Okay. It actually is a norms. Okay, norms, because this norms is not shared by the whole Malay populations or the Malay ethnic. it may be something which is specific to that family. What do you think? As a Malay yourself, is it a Malay culture? Is it something which practice in your family?
Oh, sir.
Mm.
Not in my family, at least.
Mm. Yeah. Well, I've seen this. I've seen this in a few occasions, but I don't take it as a culture, or I don't take it as a norm, and I won't make that as my culture, because, if the food is there, just eat lah. All right, then. Why is this the man eat first, then the woman eat later? It doesn't make sense to me. Doesn't make sense to me, right? What do you think, Siti Nur Shakira? What do you think?
Same, sir.
Wow, kenapa? What's your reason? Have you seen this in your family?
No.
All right. Okay. Foods. Okay. Food strongly linked to culture. Okay. Food links to culture as well. Well, this is something which is not really true. Okay. Because, usually Malay are linked to rice, nasi, you know that. But there are also Malay who eat something else, all right? Doesn't eat nasi or doesn't eat rice and all that. So, but then it's in general, when we talk about Malay will eat rice, right? So that is on the general, on the surface, okay? And then mosque is a norm with strong moral incentive, okay? Norm just now is a behavior passed down from the past. Mosque is something, is a behavior, is a norm, is a behavior which has some moral justification in it. Meaning, if you break this, then it become something. It invites moral or public lashes against you. Okay. For example, like you. You enter a Malay house without taking off your shoes. Okay, if you enter my house without taking off your shoes, the first thing that you get I will scold you. All right, get out from my house. Okay, so this is something which is most is a norm which has strong moral incentive. Okay, either positive or negative. Conventions, on the other hand, is a norm regarding everyday life. Then you may want to ask, Shireen, what's the difference between norms and conventions? Now, convention is again about language. Although norms and convention is quite similar, but norm is something about habit. Okay, norm is more about habit. Convention is something to do, it has some legal connotation in it, okay? Some legal connotation in it. Something like, it is not a habit, it is some sort like habit, but it has some element of legal, some sort of regulations in it. That's conventions, okay? For example, like, in the UK, okay, in the UK, before the parliament starts, the queen will knock on the door of the parliament, and the keeper or the registrar will open the door and slam the door, then they open again. Well, it is a convention. It is although it is not a law, but it is some sort of convention. It means something that you do every it is some sort of tradition. But it's some sort like some legal, okay, legal element in it. Okay, and it is a convention for you to listen to your king, for example. Okay, you listen to what your king said, for example. So that is something which is, well, you don't have to listen to what your king said, okay? Because the king do not have any power against you, but it is conventions that you listen when the king said something that you listen, and you obey. Okay, that's some sort of like conventions. Okay, all right. We are not living in Malay Sultanate, yeah, Malay Sultanate era, whereby the Sultan is the king. Right. Now myth. Okay, what are myth? Or Malay is mythos. Okay, now when you have this culture, okay, you need to emphasize this culture, or you need to tell this culture to the set of people. Okay, meaning for Malays, for example, you need to tell this culture, you need to educate this Malay, group of Malay, about the culture. So how do you do this? Okay, you use myth. Okay, myth is stories. Okay, myths are stories that contain symbolic element expressing the shared emotions and ideal of a culture. Means, how do you emphasize the element of the Malay culture? You use what? The myth. For example, like Sang Kancil, for example, Sang Kancil and Buaya. Sang Kancil and Buaya is a myth. Where can animal talks to each other? The Kancil talks to the Buaya. It cannot be true, right? But why? It's a myth. So it issues. Then how do you get from this cerita Sang Kancil and Buaya? Have you heard about the story about Sang Kancil and Buaya?
Lupa dah saya.
And you guys call yourself Malay.
Saya tahu yang buaya tu kena pijak kepala. Kita dah tanya-tanya lepas ni.
Sang Kancil dengan and then Arnab dan kura-kura. Sang Kancil dan monyet tu kan. So those are myths. Okay, myth. And how are you going to express? How do you tell your that population that sharing this belief? How are you going to tell that? How do you tell that quality of that culture? Do you tell it through stories? These stories are myth. Okay, through myth. Myth means stories which you know it is a fiction, but the story behind or the taladan, the takeaway of that stories will emphasize the value of that cultures. Okay, the element of that cultures like Sang Kancil dan Buaya, no, talks about you need to be very tactful. Okay, Sang Kancil dengan kura-kura, Sang Kancil dengan, you know, all those things. In fact, when we talk about ideals of a culture, for example, okay, when we talk about sejarah Melayu, any one of you have read the book of Sejarah Melayu by Tun Sri Lanang?
Kota pernah dengar saya, tapi kisah tu macam tak sangat.
Okay, have you heard about Hang Tuah dan Lima Bersaudara? Even kalau korang tak pernah baca pun buku sejarah Melayu. Although you guys calling yourself Malays, but you never read the book Sejarah Melayu by Tun Sri Lanang. Have you heard about Hang Tuah Lima Bersaudara?
Pernah, sir.
Yeah, alright. Yeah. So when you read the stories, alright? Okay, I'm not saying it is a myth. I'm not saying it is a myth. Kan ada pula certain quarters of Malay marah, kata Hang Tuah is not a myth, it's a real thing. Well, if you read if you wanted to know about Hantuah, for example, you need to read Sejarah Melayu. Okay, Sejarah Melayu by Tun Sri Lanang. Okay, this Sejarah Melayu by Tun Sri Lanang, that book, okay, Sejarah Melayu, was written sometimes after the fall of Malay Sultanate. Okay, you know, as we all know that Malay Sultanate, they collapsed because of it was invaded by the Portuguese or the Spanish.
Portuguese.
By the Portuguese, and then they wanted to record. Okay, they do not want people to forget about this dynasty, about this empire. So they this Tun Sri Lanang was entrusted to write a Malay Sejarah Melayu. Okay, then you can see that the story about Hantuah is there in the Sejarah Melayu, among others. There are a lot of things in the Sejarah Melayu, but the story about Hantuah, lima bersaudara, Hantuah and four of his brothers are there in Sejarah Melayu. Well, okay, little bit of history. Yeah. How many? Okay, when does Malay Sultanate Empire started? When is Parameswara established Melaka? Around 14 something, right? 1400 something like that. Correct?
Yes.
Right or not? Okay. Yes. When is the collapse of the Malay Sultanate, Melaka Sultanate Empire? When is the Portuguese invasions? When? 1511. It's around 100 years something, right? But yes. If you read the Sejarah Melayu, okay, if you read Sejarah Melayu, Hantuah, during the establishment of the Malay Sultanate is already he's already in adulthood, mean dah dewasa. Alright, and Hantuah been mentioned all over again in all over Sejarah Melayu until the fall of Malay Sultanate in the hands of the Portuguese. So it seems that this Hantuah lived like more than 100 of years. Alright, and the problem with Sejarah Melayu that there's no dates. Okay, there's no dates. Tak ada tarikh. Okay, tak ada tarikh. In fact, when they talk about Chinese princess from China come to and Puteri Hang Lipo, for example, that came to Melaka, for example. In Chinese record, okay, in Chinese record, there's no record on any of the princess being sent to Melaka to be married to one of the Malay Sultanate, to those Melaka Sultan. And we know for the fact that Chinese dynasty, whatever happened, they will record together with dates. Okay, you can see the records. It's all there. But there's no record of Puteri Hang Lipo from China to be married to one of the Melaka Sultan. There's no record on that. So this is, but then this myth or these stories are so entrenched in the Malay culture. And why? Because you need to express that, to express the elements of that culture, okay, the elements of that culture. So you're using myth. Okay, this is if you wanted to use this for marketing, for example, you come up with a story which aggrandize your product. You make a story which make your product looks better, looks more your product looks or become perceived to be grandier compared to your competitors. Alright. Mm. So those are myths. Okay. So how do you relate that with the modern day marketing? Myth is about aggrandizing a certain culture, emphasizing on the features of certain cultures. So if you wanted to relate that with the modern marketing, you can create a myth around your product, a story which makes your product looks larger than life. Right? So that is myth. Rituals. Okay, rituals. Hey, any one of you who doesn't agree with me on what I just said just now about hang lipo, hang tuah, and all that, you're welcome to agree to disagree. Anyone disagree with me about hang tuah and all that?
Tadi saya just mind blown je yang saya kata tak ada stated on the Chinese China's punya macam general something.
Yeah. Okay, now why? Okay, why? Dia sebab dulu zaman Melaka tu dia tak ada Facebook, okay, tak ada Instagram. So how do you enhance your image? Okay, how do you enhance your image to say that you are a rightful ruler, for example? Okay, you are a rightful ruler. So you come up with these stories, okay, myth. That's why Tun Sri Lanang he been entrusted to write these stories to make the ruler looks good. Because if you are married to someone from, you are related to the Chinese dynasty, for example, then you are some sort like a recognition that you are a rightful ruler. Okay. You know why? Because Chinese dynasty at that point of time is a very big dynasty. Okay, to be connected with that dynasty, some sort like pinjam aura, is like giving you some sort of recognition. The same thing when the story about Iskandar Zulkarnain, for example. Okay, you know that Iskandar Zulkarnain or Alexander the Great is a great ruler or conqueror in the Greek era in Greece. And there is a story in Malay, what do you call this, in Malay culture or in sejarah Melayu, saying that suddenly, out of the blue, the descendant of the Alexander the Great or Iskandar Zulkarnain suddenly appear in somewhere in Kedah and married a local nobles. And that local noble, then you be dapat waris and become a king or a king at that point of time in that area. So why is this story about suddenly a descendant of Alexander the Great appear in Bukit Seguntang somewhere in Kedah, and that descendant of their descendant become a king in that area? So what do you think this the purpose of this story?
Naikkan nama Kedah.
That is thing that but can you imagine at that point of time the transportation is so lambat, you need to take kapal daripada Greece pergi ke Kedah. But then it doesn't say that descendant of Alexander the Great naik kapal, it just suddenly appear out of the blue, tada, there in Bukit Seguntang. So I'm not saying this is not sedition, okay? I'm talking in the terms of culture, okay? Aggrandizing the elements of that culture. You are saying that just now we're talking about pinjaman culture, right? Copy culture. And this is about taking credits of some cultures or some dynasty to give some sort of legitimacy of your position. Okay, it's the same as product, for example. Like you are Dell, for example. Okay, Dell wanted to sell a laptop, and he said Intel Inside. Intel Inside, meaning it is powered by Intel microprocessor. What is this? What Dell is trying to say or try to communicate to the consumer? Is Intel is part of Dell? Is Intel is the product of Dell?
No.
Then why Dell must say that Intel Inside? Powered by Intel microprocessor. Why?
It's because Intel is a famous brand.
So it
build
gives
trust,
some sort,
sir. Build trust.
Build trust. It gives some sort of credibility, right, to that product.
Yes.
It's the same concept, my friend. Okay, it's the same concept. So then let's look at rituals. Hey, you guys tak pernah baca all those sejarah Melayu?
Ada tapi tak ingat sih. Saya ingat sikit-sikit. Bila-bila macam tu lah.
Mana ingat sih?
Lupa betul sih.
Saya banyak study sejarah company ni. Masuk degree ni.
Sejarah apa?
Sejarah company.
What sejarah company. Oh. Alright, I'm sure you do that. Okay.
Terang business student, bukan history.
Yeah, but then it doesn't harm you to read all those things.
There's a gurau, is
it? I know. It's a gurau. It's just like, no, it's like it widens your knowledge. It widens your knowledge. It's something that you can learn. Why? Because history repeat itself. For example, like Facebook, right? Facebook essentially is something which is history repeating itself. For example, like the walls written, the painting on the walls of the pyramid, for example, telling stories, telling the story of the pharaoh to the public, okay, by painting pictures on the walls. That is the human habit or human behavior since human live in the cave, and then there's a civilization in Egypt, the same behavior up until now in 2020, whereby you read or you put in your story in Instagram, Facebook or TikTok, the same behavior again and again throughout history. So that's why I said that it doesn't hurt for you to read about history, read about philosophy, you know, that it widens your knowledge, one thing, but somehow you can learn, you can see that history repeat itself, okay, again and again, again and again. All right,
dia boleh bubuh good elements from the history to apa nak bubuh element to our business. Betul tak, sir?
Yeah, correct. For example, like retro, for example, retro music. Okay, retro music is 1970s, right? For example, like the songs, these songs like "Killing Me Softly," for example. No, "I Love You, Baby." I love you, baby. Something like that. It's a very old song, right? 1950 something like that. And suddenly it repeats itself in, I think, sometime early this year, right? So it's a very old songs, retro something in 1970s, and it repeats itself again, okay, in 2020s. So it's all history, okay? You say that Frank Sinatra, for example, "Fly Me to the Moon." Not Frank Sinatra is 1950s. Okay, I heard Frank Sinatra when I was young. Then even that Frank Sinatra is beyond my time. In 1950s, 60s, you know that. Frank Sinatra, okay? "Fly Me to the Moon." And suddenly I can hear "Fly Me to the Moon" sang by a different singer in TikTok. All right, given a fresh breath, something new, something fresh. All right, so again, it's history. That's history. Okay, so doesn't mean that you just look at the IR 4.0 and all that, but sometimes you need to look at the back. Okay, you look at the at history, and you know that history going to repeat itself, and it going to be trendy again. Right, so that is histories. Now let's look at this rituals. So ritual is something a symbolic behavior. Okay, it is not a norm, because norm is something which is shared by a group of people, but ritual is something which is more smaller. Okay, the subset is quite smaller. Rituals, for example, like before you answer your exam, for example, or what are the things that you do? That is your ritual.
Like recite the doa.
Recite the doa and all that. For example, like for me, to an exam, I don't read. I mean, I read the book or read my notes the day before until I literally wanted to puke. Then I just stop. Then I, for the whole night, I won't read the notes again. And the ritual is I'm not going to look at my notes even before the exam. Okay, pantang. No, that's ritual. Okay, that's ritual. That's my ritual. Okay. I believe that if I read my notes just before the exam, something bad will happen during the exam. So that's no ritual. Rite of passage. Okay, rite of passage is a set of event or behavior that move an individual from one state to another. That rite of passage means you are transforming yourself from one culture or subculture to another culture or subculture. Okay, and then sacred consumption. Okay, sacred consumption is some place that are set apart as special because something great or significant happened there. Sometimes mystical or religious. For example, like for Muslim, for example, for sacred consumption is you need to go to Mecca to do your Umrah or Haji. Okay, but then to go to Mecca for Umrah and Haji, it may be it requires some money, right? You need to say appoint a travel agent, for example, for you to perform your Umrah, to get your visa or mutawif, you know that. Alright, so that Mecca itself is what we call sacred consumption. It's just it's a place whereby something great happened there. Okay, sometimes it's religious, sometimes it's mystical. Sometimes mystical, sometimes it's religious. Because for us, for Islam, it's very religious. Why? Because something happened there. And then the God said that you need to perform haji at least once, okay, in your life, if you are able to. Or if you are not, then you can go for Umrah and all that. Why you go to Mecca, not to Dubai, for example, to perform your haji or Umrah?
Because the religion stated we need to perform the Hajj at the Mecca.
Yeah, so what happened in Mecca?
You know, performing the Tawaf and all that.
Yes, because we are reenacting Abraham and Ismail. Okay, what they did in Mecca. Okay, so this is what happened in Mecca. Can be some mystical or like Stonehenge, for example, in the UK, in Britain. Stonehenge, for example, is mystical, right? Ganges River, for example. Okay, Ganges River. Why Hindu goes to Ganges River? Because of some mystical or religious factors, right? That sacred consumption. So what are the product yang relevant to this sacred consumption is maybe travel agency for Umrah, you know that. Right, now Hofstede. Okay, we go for this philosopher Hofstede. Okay, four cultural dimensions. What is the time now? 2:20. Right, Hofstede. Okay, four cultural dimension. According to Hofstede, there are four cultural dimensions. Meaning when you wanted to look at culture, you may look at these four dimensions according to Hofstede. So Hofstede ni dia buat dia buat study in 66 countries involving 6,000 respondent, but all these respondent are IBM employees, because Hofstede is he works with IBM. So IBM has operation in a lot of countries. So he conducted his study in 66 countries where IBM have presence and located, and then all the respondent, all these subject that answer his questionnaires are IBM employees, right? So based on Hofstede, when you look at culture, you can look at these four dimensions: individuals against collectivism. Individual means, are you individualistic? Are you selfish? Are you advancing your own self-interest? Are you being collective, meaning you look at the benefit or the good of the community as a whole? Okay, so this is the culture. Or are you, number two, uncertainty of avoidance? Means in certain culture, they avoid risk, means they avoid something which is uncertain. Like Malaysia last time, we do not want to try something new. Why? Because new things is something uncertain. When you do something which is uncertain, there is risk. So you want to be, you become risk avoidance. Okay, you just wanted, you're safe, you feel safe with what you have. So you do not want to do something new. You doesn't want to try something new. You doesn't want to learn something new. Why? Because something new is something which is uncertain. Something which is uncertain come with risk. So you are risk avoidance. So there are some culture which is avoiding risk. Risk avoidance. Power distance, number three. Power distance means between those who are in power and those who are not with power. Okay, the classes. Now, for example, okay, I give you what, like when I was a student. Okay, of course we during class we ask question, we bombarded the lecturers with question and all that, but outside the lecture hall, when we at the corridor, when we see the lecturer at one end of the corridor walking towards us, we're going to take another way, another route, just to avoid the lecturers. It doesn't mean that we don't like the lecturers. Okay, it doesn't mean that we don't like the lecturers. We respect the lecturers. We are okay with the lecture, but to bump into a lecturer outside the classroom, outside the lecture hall, is something that macam we are so awkward, awkward. So we took another route, just to avoid bumping into the lecturer on the hallway. But during class, we ask questions lah. We don't have a problem with that, communicating with the lecturer during class. But different now, students are less power distance, with the lecturers. Okay, for example, just like you guys do not have any reservation in talking to the lecturers. Message lecturer malam-malam Sabtu Ahad dan holiday pun rasa macam tak bersalah. All those things, right? So the power distance is it become narrow and narrow. The gap is become narrow and narrow. I don't see that you need to have power distance. Okay, what I'm saying is you need to strike a balance. Okay, you need to have a balance. Okay, you need to have a balance. Means there's a pros and cons. Okay, there's a pros and cons. Because, for example, in the East, in Eastern culture, for example, there is a power distance. So, like lecturer and students, boss and employee, parents and children, and all that. Okay, leaders and citizen, normal citizen, right? There's always a power distance, but in Western countries, the power distance is quite narrow. The gap is quite narrow. So if you want to ask me which one is better, less power distance or more power distance, my answer will be you need to strike a balance. Okay, you need to strike a balance. Masculinity and femininity. Okay, this is about whether that culture is more patriarchal. For example, patriarchal is about it's all about men. Okay, whereby men is in the center of that culture. Like just now when I talk about in Twitter, this guy talking about the guy eat first, after the guy finish eating, then only the woman will eat. That is masculinity. That is more, it's very patriarchal culture. Okay. But in some culture, this is not the case. Okay, this is not the case. The is equal. That's why you hear about. But even if even in the Western countries like Americas and Europe, you still have this debacle. You still have these issues on equal payment based on gender. From the research, it shows that for every ₱1 that men receive, the woman still in America, for example, still receive for 80 cents for each $1 that received by the man. Okay, meaning to say there is a disparity on payments, okay, based on gender. And on career, for example, career advancement, for example. Okay, you see here, okay, if you can look at the list of people here in this class, for example, as a sample, you can see that more women than men. Okay, there's more women student compared to men student. Right here, the composition. But as you go along, go for the career, for example, for career advancement, okay, you see people at the top. You see less and less women. Why do you think this is happening? Now, why do you think this phenomenon happened? About the career advancement of women. Nur Idina. Nur Idina.
Yes, sir.
Why do you think that there's not many women in at the top position? Why? Politically, in the companies, for example, in Malaysian Parliament, for example, you don't see a lot of women assemblymen. In the companies, you don't see a lot of women holding top position as CEOs, everything. Why?
Sebab selalu kan kalau macam pemimpin dia basically selalu untuk lelaki kan. So kalau perempuan ni susah sikit, mungkin sebab diorang ada thought yang lain.
Apa yang lain tu? Apa yang lain? Why do you think this happening? Even in you as a woman, why do you think that not many women holding top posts in companies? Macam tadi yang baca tentang history companies tu kan? I think you may find the answers there also. Why do you think that no not many companies, not many women holding top posts in a company. Not only in Malaysia, even this matter been raised in the Silicon Valley in America about, for example, in a book by Emily Chang, talking about bro utopia, okay, talking about how men controlling Silicon Valley. So that's in America, okay. In Malaysia, it's even worse. So why do you think this happening?
Macam mungkin kalau perempuan jadi pemimpin, dia orang selalu buat keputusan tu ikut emotional. Lepas tu dia orang selalu macam take benda tu personal lah daripada lelaki. That's why macam kalau lelaki ni dia lebih rational sikit. Dia macam fikir jauh lah. Kalau perempuan ni dia macam fikir untuk short term je macam tu.
Betul ke? Is it perception or is it fact?
Perception.
Okay, now as a woman himself, katalah that is the perception of the public in general. But as a woman, why do you think that woman doesn't go far or doesn't want to go far in their career sometimes? Okay, most of the times. Why? I said most of the time because the composition of women holding top posts in companies, either in Malaysia or in Europe and US, is not as many as the men. Why do you think? As a woman yourself, you said that, okay, that the gender perception is I make emotional decision, but if I need to prove that wrong. I need to prove them wrong. So, but yet, why I don't see why we still talk about gender equal payment for gender. We're talking about the participation of women in politics. Why we still talking about women participation in the management of companies? Why we still talk about this in the year 2020? Why? Ni siapa yang baca tentang history companies tadi? Muhammad Azim Aiman, I think. Betul kan? Muhammad Azim Aiman. Why do you think?
In
Azim. Oh, Azim. Yes. Muhammad Azim Aiman, where are you?
Ya, saya sir.
Dengar. What was your opinion, Muhammad Azim Aiman?
Sekali lagi sir.
Why do you think that in the year 2020, we're still talking about women's participation in the top management of companies? Why we're still talking about equal payment for men and women? Why we're still talking about women's participation in politics?
Cuma nak cakap lah. Sekejap sahaja.
Nama buku tadi apa saya? Utopia apa? Silicon Valley. Yeah.
No, I just give you an example. Emily Chang, her book about Blue Utopia in Silicon Valley. But then, that is just an example of her book. But I'm talking about this issue in general. What do you think? What is your opinion about this issue?
Those are my book list.
See, what I'm trying to do here, okay, is to shorten the gap of the power distance. When I was still young, when I was in primary, I cannot ask question. Okay, the teacher doesn't give me any chance to ask question. If I ask question, I'm wrong. I need to get out from the class. Okay, but as we progresses, okay, as we progresses in the year 2020, the power distance, the culture should be shortened. Okay, the distance between a lecturer or a teacher and the students need to be shortened. All right, but you need to take this opportunity. Yeah, when a lecturer giving you so much opportunity for you to ask question and so much opportunity for you to give opinions, this is something that the new generation need to take opportunity on. Why? Because the current crowd of lecturers, they're quite receptive to opinions. Okay, I'm quite receptive for opinions from my students. So as a student, okay, as a student in a class, okay, you need to give, okay, some and take some. For example, just now when we talk about the articles, all right, case study, giving and taking, giving and receiving. The same thing as knowledge. Okay, knowledge is about giving and receiving. If you just wanted to receive knowledge, you won't learn. Okay, you won't learn. You need to give something, then you receive something. So the law, okay, the law is the same. Okay, the law is the principle is all the same. So as a student, okay, as a marketer, whereby you're going to be in the knowledge industry. To be in the knowledge industry, you need to have, first, you need to have knowledge. All right, so if you do have knowledge, so to be in the knowledge industry is quite difficult. Okay, to work in the knowledge industry, but without knowledge. It's a contradiction in terms. Okay, it's a contradiction in terms. All right, it's cool. All right. Opinions, no opinions here, you know that. Okay. All right. Okay, let's talk about, okay, now it's 2:38. Okay, now I skip this subculture. You go and read yourself. And I want to talk about the social class. Okay, social class. Okay, go to the slide on social mobility, also known as social class. Okay, further down. Right, what is social class? Okay, social class is basically a class of, for example, like the M40, B40, top 20, that is a form of social class. Okay, it's a form of social class. And why is this so important? Because different social class would require different type of products. All right, now let's look at a different view on social class. Okay, for Marxist, okay, Marxist is the one who talks about communism, you know that. Okay, according to Marx, Karl Marx, social class is the power and ideas of the aristocrat to control the, what do you call this, the citizen or the lower rank of the people. Why? Because Karl Marx, when he came up with this idea, okay, about communism, he at the point of time, in Russia, Karl Marx is from Russia, right? In Russia, it was controlled by a royalty, like controlled by a Caesar, okay, by a king. And the king, they live lavishly, they live with all these branded goods and all that. They live basically like God. And normal people live in languishing, okay, meaning that they are poor. It's very hard, okay, they live a very hard life. So when Karl Marx come up with this issue on socialism, that socialism was written based on this background, okay. So Karl Marx's view of social class whereby according to Karl Marx, social class is a form of a method to oppress the people, right? It different from Weber's view of social class. Okay, Weber is a capitalist. Okay, capitalist background. So it talks about lower class, middle class, and upper class. But the lower class can transcend from the bottom to going upward, and also downward. Meaning, if you work hard, okay, you work hard, you're able to go up the ladder. Okay, do based on Weber. But then for marketers' view on social class, they look more on the how are you going to sell product based on the class, certain class, different product. Okay, certain class, different service that they would require. All right, so this is based on the view on classes. Now, questions. From marketers' viewpoint, social class are used to describe subculture based on education, occupational requirement, and economic power, or in bracket, political power of the individual part of the individual members. Meaning to say, as a marketer, you use this social class to describe subculture of certain people. For example, these certain people, they are living their life based on their education. Okay, their subculture are influenced by their educations, by their occupations, and their requirement and economic power. Meaning to say, if someone who has someone who is well educated, pays very well, so he may need something which is, for example, like they're more conscious on their health. They're more conscious about the environment, for example. Okay, for example, like someone who is well off, okay, very rich, he may opted to buy electric car. Why? Because it is good for environment. But we know that electric car is very expensive compared to a vehicle which is run by gas or by petroleum, by fossil fuel. Okay, it's much cheaper. So not say poor, but for example, M40, people who are in the M40 class, all right, when they wanted to buy a car, they wanted to buy a vehicle, they do not have the capacity. Okay, they know that vehicle which consume fossil fuel is bad for the environment, but they do not have choice. Why? Because electric car, it costs much more than compared to a normal car. Okay, but for people who are rich, people who have money, disposable income, they have the power, they have the ability to buy electric car. Why? Because they can. Okay, they can. So they're more doesn't mean that those who are the middle class and the middle M40 and all that, or B40, they don't care about the environment. They know the harm that caused to the environment, but they do not have a choice. Okay, so as a marketer, you need to be able to know what kind of product which suitable to different classes of people. All right. Do you have any question before I end this class?
No, sir.
Okay, tak ada. Kalau tak ada, no question. Alright. Now, the next slide is summary. Okay, the summary is a summary which summarizes the topic today. Alright. You will see the summary there, the next slide. Then, after the summary, you see the slide on do you see questions? These questions is for your own. Your own study, your own revision.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah.
apa? Kita punya quiz tu bila, sir?
Quiz apa?
Quiz ni ah. Tak ada quiz ke untuk subjek ni?
Eh, tak ada.
Oh, yeah.
Eh, awak ada for the coursework. Coursework,
oh,
right?
Subjek ni quiz tak ada ah.
Tak ada. Coursework ni untuk consumer behavior awak ada individual assignment. Then you have group assignment.
Oh, tu je lah. Dua tu je lah.
Group assignment awak 40 marks. Meaning 24 presentation, 24 I think for your reports, I think. If I'm not mistaken.
Oh, then, okay.
Quiz tak ada? Awak nak quiz ke?
Tak lah, sebab selalu subjek lain ada. So, tu tanya saya tu.
Dah, tak ada. Because this one, for ANP, I teach another subject which is called advertising and promotion, right? For ANP, yes, ada quiz. Okay, but for this subject, I value this subject more than ANP. Because this subject is quite philosophical. It's quite it requires your analytical, your analytical ability to think about the subject. Okay, because it's
itulah. Nanti takut sebagi quiz macam yang subjek advertising and promotion tu lah, banyak sejarah-sejarah yang tak ada nota tu. Takut juga nanti sebagi macam tu, macam banyak general knowledge lah.
Yeah, because question for this, you can't kalau buat dalam bentuk quiz, it doesn't insult your intelligence, right? I assume or I perceive a student who took this subject is intelligent student, alright? At this stage, I assume and I take it that you are all intelligence. Okay, yang mana yang ANP, apa e-marketing tu semua yang ranking bawah-bawah tu. Yang ambil consumer behavior ni dia dah macam tahap dewa dah. So takkan nak jawab soalan MCQ. Doesn't give any apa ni? What do you call this? Tak ada challenge. Alright. Okay, Farida Hanim.
Alright.
Okay. Tapi awak sebab janganlah awak anggap macam aku ambil ANP. No. Kalau awak lihat on the course structure, okay, if you look at the course structure, you supposed to take ANP first, then consumer behavior is a bit later. Correct? Kalau awak tengok dalam course structure, why? Because the rationale is by the time that you take consumer behavior, which is at the later part of your coursework or your course structure, it was assumed that you have attained some sort or some degree of maturity, some degree of intellectual capacity, okay, a degree higher of intellectual capacity by the time that you take consumer behavior. Alright. Okay, any questions apart from exams and all that? Ada tak? Tak ada?
So far.
Alright. Okay. Bukan cool, tak ada soalan. Cool sebab awak faham. Alright. So now, kalau tak ada, saya stop the lecture now. So next week, we're going to start with the case study yang selepas ni. Alright, maksudnya kalau awak lihat case study dalam your VLE, ada case study tentang skuter tu. Okay, so we're going to talk about that case study before we proceed to another lecture for next week. Okay?
Alright.
All right. See you guys next week. Stay safe.